This is the videotaped deposition of Elliot Mintz in the matter of Damiano versus Sony Music and Bob Dylan.
Have you ever lied to Mr. Damiano?
Yes.
Yeah, we started to meet these people who'd really just been in newspapers and on film. You know, we actually were rubbing shoulders with them.
He was one of them.
He was our idol.
Bob was our hero.
Not an idol, but we just heard his record. As I said, we listened to his album and it really gave us a buzz, and we played it constantly over and over and over again.
I mean, I heard of Bob through John. He'd played the records to me, and it was just great.
I think it was freewheeling.
We love Bob Dylan.
Oh, what did you see? My blind son, and what did you see, my darling young one? Son, newborn baby with wild wolves all around it. So how we've done.
Thanks, Bruce. That's great. Well, I'd like to thank the board of directors and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for inducting me.
Through extensive research, we have discovered that Bob Dylan's songwriting process is obscure. Obscure in the sense that with many of his songs, he has taken a melody line from a pre-existing song and simply changed the words. After doing so, he would credit his name to the songs by either printing his name under the song, and in some cases, by printing written by Bob Dylan on the album or CD. This process is misleading, whereby his fans would believe that he had written the entire song, including the melody, which could be the hardest part of writing a song. For decades, Dylan managed to be inconspicuous and depended on his fans' lack of musical knowledge to accomplish that feat. The song you are about to hear, Down on the Corner, is written by John Fogerty and Creedence Clearwater Revival. The song peaked at number 3 on the Hot 100 charts on December of 1969.
Early in the evening, just about supper time.
The following song, Shelter from the Storm, was a song released by Bob Dylan.
'Twas in another lifetime, one of toil and blood.
Here is the comparison again.
Early in the evening, just about supper time.
'Twas in another lifetime,
one of toil and blood.
Here is the comparison again.
Was in another lifetime, one of toil and blood.
The next song is Berthelou, written by Dorsey Burnett, which reached number 16 on the charts in 1966. Simply changed the name Berthelou to Rita Mae, and as you could hear, he plagiarized the melody line. Dylan collected the royalties to Rita Mae and never credited Dorsey as the author of the song.
Rita Mae, Rita Mae.
Bob Dylan misled his fans by taking credit for the melody of Blowing in the Wind. Most songs consist of two elements, the lyrics and the music. In an interview, Dylan states that he wrote Blowing in the Wind in 10 minutes, misleading his fans into believing that he wrote the lyrics and the music. He may have written the lyrics, however, it is common knowledge now, after all these years, that Dylan did not write the melody and that the melody was plagiarized from the song No More Auction Block.
I read somewhere that you wrote Blowing in the Wind in 10 minutes. Is that right?
Probably.
Just like that?
Yeah.
Where did it come from?
It came from right out of that wellspring of creativity, I would think, you know.
That.
After being asked about Blowing in the Wind, Dylan does not elaborate about his songwriting process. Had Dylan been honest with the world, he would have elaborated and stated that the melody line was already in existence, and that all that needed to be done to complete the song was to simply change the words. You could hear that the melody of Blowing in the Wind is the same melody as No More Auction Block.
Must a man walk down before you call him a man? Yes, and how many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? Yes, and how many times must the cannonballs fly before they fall out?
of a band. The answer, my friend, is a blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Side was first performed at New York's Town Hall on April 12, 1963, which also happened to be Dylan's debut appearance at that venue. Although Dylan claims it is an original composition, the melody to With God on Our Side bears a striking resemblance to The Patriot Game by Dominic Beam. Beam called Bob Dylan a plagiarist and a thief when he plagiarized Beam's folk masterpiece, The Patriot Game, and used it as the underlying lyrical and melodic structure of his 1963 song, With God on Our Side. Dylan never responded. The following comparison is of the two songs in question.
He's just arrived here to sing at the Royal Festival Hall, and his latest protest is called With God on Our Side.
Oh, my name, it ain't nothing. My age, it means less. The country I come from is called the Midwest. I was taught and brought up there, the laws to abide, and that the land that I live in has has God on its side.
Unless you can show your own knowledge of people and politics in song. Come all ye young rebels and list while I sing. Now love of one's land is a terrible thing. It banishes fear with the speed of a flame. And it makes us all part of the patriot game. My name is O'Hanlon. I'm just...
Oh, my name, it ain't nothing. My age, it means less.
Come all ye young rebels and list while I sing.
It ain't nothing, my age it means less.
As you could see from the record label, Bob Dylan credited his name to the song with God on Our Side, as he did in all the songs that he plagiarized over the years. In 1996, when critics started scrutinizing the origin of Dylan's songs, his camp started contacting journalists to have them write articles stating that Dylan had recognized the authors of these songs by mentioning the author during a concert that was performed years ago. However, had the listener not been at the concert, he would have no way of knowing that the song was not written by Dylan. To reiterate, the record label states that the author of the song is Bob Dylan. Still, to this day, Dylan receives the proceeds from the royalties on sold albums without paying royalties to the author or their beneficiaries.
I like to think of it more in terms of vision music. It's mathematical music.
Would you say that the words were more important than the music?
The words are just as important as the music. There'd be no music without the words.
Which do you do first, ordinarily?
The words.
Do you think there will ever be a time when you will paint or sculpt?
Oh, yes. Oh, sure.
Do you think there ever be a time when you hung as a thief?
You weren't supposed to say that.
Can we have a match?
Yes.
Bob, you said when you always do your words first and you think of it as music. When you do the words, can you hear it?
Can I hear it?
Can you sort of hear what music you want when you do your words?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Do you hear any music before you have words? Do you have any songs that you don't have words to yet?
Sometimes on very gentle instruments, not on the guitar, though. Maybe something like the harpsichord or the harmonica or auto harp, I might hear some kind of melody or tune, which I would know the words to put to.
You'd say that.
Yes, not with the guitar though. The guitar is too hard an instrument. I don't really hear many melodies based on the guitar.
Do you sit down just to write a song, or do you come to write it on inspiration?
I'm more or less writing on a lot of things.
Since the beginning of Bob Dylan's music career, his modus operandi was to steal a song here and there. He would take one song from one author and another song from another author, instead of taking many songs from one author. Many authors never even realized that their song had been stolen from Bob Dylan, since no one ever made a comparison. Dylan had a unique way of disguising the words so that no one would realize that he had plagiarized the song, or in most cases, the melody of the song. In James Damiano's case, Dylan decided to do just the opposite and stole many songs from Damiano. This movie is the missing link to the saga of Bob Dylan's plagiarisms. Bob Dylan's friendship with Paul Clayton dates back to 1961, Dylan's first year in New York City. Dylan traveled cross-country with Clayton and two other friends in 1963. A song Paul Clayton wrote was the basis for one of Bob Dylan's most famous songs, Don't Think Twice, It's All Right. Dylan and Clayton's publishing company sued each other over the plagiarism. The lawsuit was settled out of court. Following is a comparison of the two songs.
Well, it ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. And it ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. It don't matter anyhow when your rooster crows at the break of dawn. Look out your window and I'll be gone. You're the reason I'm traveling on. Don't think twice, it's all right. And it ain't no use in turning on your light, babe. It ain't no use in turning on your light, babe. I'm on the dark side of the road. Still,
oh, it ain't no use to sit and sigh now, darling. And it ain't no use to sit and cry now. It ain't no use to sit and wonder why, darling. Just wonder who's gonna buy you ribbons when I'm gone. So time's on the railroad getting hard, babe. I woke up last night and saw it snow. Remember what you said to me last summer. When you see me walking down that road, so it ain't no use to sit and sigh now.
Well, it ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. And it ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. It don't matter anyhow when your rooster crows at the break of dawn. Look out your window and I'll be gone. You're the reason I'm traveling on.
Don't think twice, it's all right. Oh, it ain't no use to sit and sigh now, darling. And it ain't no use to sit and cry now. It ain't no use to sit and wonder why, darling. Just wonder who's gonna buy you ribbons when I'm gone. So time's on the railroad.
Oh,
it ain't no use to sit and sigh now, darling. And it ain't no use to sit and cry now. Ain't no use to sit and wonder why, darling. Just wonder who's gonna buy you ribbons when I'm...
Clayton dates back to 1961, Dylan's first year in New York City. Dylan traveled cross-country with Clayton and two other friends in 1963. A song Paul Clayton wrote was the basis for one of Bob Dylan's most famous songs, Don't Think Twice, It's All Right. Dylan and Clayton's publishing company sued each other over the plagiarism. The lawsuit was settled out of court. Following is a comparison of the two songs.
Well, it ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. And it ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. It don't matter anyhow when your rooster crows at the break of dawn. Look out your window.
Oh, it ain't no use to sit and sigh now, darling. And it ain't no use to sit and cry now. It ain't no use to sit and wonder why, darling. Just wonder who's gonna buy you ribbons when I'm gone. So time's on the railroad getting hard, babe. I woke up last night and saw it snow. Remember what you said to me last summer. When you see me walking down that road, so it ain't no use to sit and sigh now.
I will be the video operator for today. Today's date is 6696. This is a case of James Damiano versus Sony Music Entertainment Incorporated and Bob Dylan. And the case number is 95-4795. We're here at the offices of Parcher and Hayes, located at 500 Fifth Avenue, New York, New York. And this is a deposition of Tony Tiller. This time, counsel will identify themselves.
Stephen Kramer for the plaintiff.
Horace Knight and Ruth Lott for Sony Music Entertainment, Inc. and Bob Dylan.
At this time, I have the court reporter swear on the witness.
Raise your right hand, sir. Do you swear the testimony you are about to give that you will tell the whole truth to help you out?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Mr. Tiller, good morning. You are employed by whom, sir?
Sony Music.
And how long have you been employed by Sony Music?
For 9 years on staff.